So I'm talking about quantum black hole phenomenology, and as you can see in the picture, there is a primordial landscape, because I'm going to focus on primordial black holes, and of course you see a big explosion that is maybe harming the poor dinosaur there. So let's start. Okay, so you have heard about this model, but let me rephrase it in one slide. So we start from the usual picture of in the Penrose diagram, in which you can see a singularity and an horizon, and of course there is some Hawking evaporation there. And the idea is that instead of a singularity, we replace the singularity with a quantum region. And so it's important to note that instead of an horizon, we have a trapping surface there. And then we wanted to take some approximations. In particular, we wanted to neglect the dissipative effects of the Hawking radiation. So, of course, the Hawking radiation is there, but you can consider it as a secondary process with respect to the main quantum process, the bouncing one. If I remove the dissipation, then the process I have is a fully time invariant. The process I have is completely invariant under time reversal. So this means that I can take the time reverse process of a black hole, of the contraction of a collapse, that is a white hole, and I can glue it there in the future of the black hole. So I don't have just a trapping surface here, I have also an anti-trapping surface. So this is the surface from which everything has to go in, and this is a trapping surface, anti-trapping surface, that means that everything has to go out from there. And finally, in the simplified model that you have seen, following the lesson by Eichek and Kiefer, the metric that has been written so far is a metric for a collapsing null shell. So, of course, we need to generalize this metric to a more complicated one. But for the moment, this already provide, for the first time, a full metric that describes this tunneling process. So maybe I can add here something, that the idea is that, so you can see it as a tunneling, or another way that we have to see it is the fact that inside this quantum region, gravity becomes repulsive. So there is an effective force. You can write down effective equations, in fact, in which you have this repulsive force that appears in the quantum regime. And this is something that is well studied in loop quantum gravity, but it seems to be a universal class, something universal to different approaches to quantum gravity. For instance, we see it also in asymptotic safety. So in my opinion, a good theory, whatever you like one approach or the other, you should ask to your theory of quantum gravity to account for this repulsive force in the deep quantum regime. And this is the way in which singularities, cosmological black hole singularities, are solved. Okay, so the main feature, I think, of this model is this huge time dilatation. The fact that for an observer sitting at the center of at the center of the collapsing shells, the proper time of the process is just a few milliseconds, while seen from outside, it could be billion years. So this explains why, despite the fact that this model predicts that black holes will explode, of course we still see black holes there in the sky. It's just that they are like stars, exploding stars in very slow motion. Let me go back. I wanted to say something more here. All the dynamics of the model is determined just by one parameter, that is the mass of the collapsing shell. Once you know the mass, you know everything about the model. But there is something missing, that is the relation between the mass and the lifetime of this dying black hole. And this is the crucial relation that we are trying to understand better right now. But because so this means that once you have the lifetime of the black hole, you can derive its original mass, and basically you can say everything about the phenomenological properties you expect. So this lifetime should be computed in a full quantum theory. It can be used. It can be computed in loop quantum gravity. Maybe it can be computed also using semi-classical techniques. But in the meanwhile, we can, in every case, constrain the minimal and the maximal lifetime of these objects using some heuristic arguments. And the first one. The first heuristic arguments come from the notorious fireworks argument. That is the fact that our basic assumptions about physics, like unitarity, the equivalence principles, and so on, they cannot hold together once we go beyond a black hole that has lost more than half of its mass. So this means that, so this is a paradox. And we quantum gravitists, we used to think that quantum gravity should enter into the game before we find the paradox. So it means that something should happen before we reach the page time. So still the page time is of the order of m cube. So m cube is the lifetime that we used to have if the process was dominated by Hockian evaporation. In this case, well, the maximal time is just half of this m cube, so still on the order of m cube. We have another argument to say what should be the minimal amount of time that this process should take, because as Carlo was explaining before, in order for this quantum process to happen, we need quantum effects to leak out of the horizon. So time, the lifetime should be long enough for this to happen. And this means that, Carlo has explained this very well, the fact that what is relevant is not just, what is relevant in order to enter in the quantum regime is not just the curvature, but the product of the curvature with time. And this means that it's enough for the lifetime to be of the order of m squared. So between m cube and m squared, there is a huge difference. And what we have done, what I will show you is a study for everything that can happen between these two values. So we have analyzed the phenomenology associated with all the possible explosion associated with the lifetime between m squared and m cube. Yeah, okay. So as I said, the most important relation that we have to consider is this one. The relation between the mass and the time. And in particular, I can put the time, the lifetime, equal to the Hubble time, the age of the universe. And so I can find back what would be the mass associated with black holes that are exploding now. So black holes whose explosion we can actually detect now. And there is a relation, of course, between this is just the usual Schwarzschild radius that tells once I have the mass, I know how big is the corresponding object. And so our idea was that the signal would be dominated by a wavelength that corresponds exactly to the size of the object that is exploding. So this radius here gives me the wavelength, the lambda, that I will that I predict from the model. I call this a low energy channel for the moment, for the model, because there is also another possibility, namely that the total signal could have another component that comes directly from the particles, the photons actually, that created the black hole. So because of the fact that the process is very fast, so in the proper time of the particle falling in, the process takes a few milliseconds. So the idea is that those particles will come out with basically the same energy, the same temperature as they had when they fall in. So this means that if we are considering primordial black holes, those formed in the early universe, so the energy corresponding to this signal is in the TIV, so that is the energy corresponding to the temperature in the very early universe when those primordial black holes formed. Actually, this is very interesting because if this is true, this opens a new window to explore the early universe now. So you can, if the model was more reliable and more defined than what it is, this could provide us a way to make measures about what was the temperature of the universe at the time when primordial black holes formed. Okay, so there are a few characteristics that I want to highlight about the signal. Of course, the idea is that everything disappears after the burst. You don't have any further remnants, or you don't have an object there that can still emit something. So if you look for a repetition of the burst, or if you look for other emission, you will see nothing. And Well, sure. The point is that I'm taking the point of view of somebody doing astrophysics. You want to distinguish this object from other objects. So, of course, if you see the same signal being repeated, this is not the kind of object I'm describing. Actually, there is a possibility that you have a repetition because there could be some lensing, but this is another story. This is also a possibility. I will discuss this later. It will enter in the discussion. So, okay, this is the main framework. And I wanted to put some numbers there because, those are the numbers. So, as Carlo was saying, the favorite model is the one in which the lifetime is m squared. So, the corresponding primordial black hole for this lifetime is a black hole of 10 to the 23 kilograms, that is basically the mass of Venus. So, it's the mass of a small planet. And this means in particular that, so if you believe that is the right value, you cannot observe burst corresponding to, so there should be no primordial black holes around that have mass smaller than this, because they have already exploded. So the fact that with the Kepler mission, you don't see any primordial black holes smaller than this is compatible with this model. Of course, they have already exploded. Okay, so this is a mass that is not too small, not too big. It stays between the range of the standard range of primordial black holes. And its energy corresponds to this. So if everything would explode, all this mass would explode, it corresponds to this flux of big flux of energy. So now the question is, have we already seen something like this in the sky? Have the astronomers already detected something like this? Well, let me discuss the possibility of detection. And this is a recent work that is in collaboration with Barreau, Bollier, and Weimar. Weimar is a student here at in Stockholm. So what we have done in this work was to consider, to study how far can we see the explosion. What is the maximum distance at which we can we would be able to see the explosion? So in this graph, so those graphs are one for the low energy channel and the other one for the high energy channel. This is the one related to the size of the black hole, and this is the one related to the temperature of the particles. So let me start from the one on your on the left. And what you can see here is this is the distance, and this is the lifetime. Well, this is the mass of the black hole that is parameterized with respect to the different lifetime. So here on the left you have black holes with short lifetime, namely with a lifetime of m squared, and on this side you have a black hole with lifetime m cubed. So what happens is that if the lifetime is m squared, basically, we have access to all possible explosions in the whole universe, because you see the maximal distance is above the Hubble radius. So we have virtually access of all the explosions in the universe. Maybe you can notice some threshold in this graph. This is given by the fact that corresponds to the optical band in which we have larger telescopes, so the detectability grows because of this. And this is a threshold that is due to the fact that this energy, we are beyond the QCD confinement, so there is the production of new particles, and in particular, we have the production because of the decay of the decay of pions, and this rises the photon productions in the process. So our best the possibility we hope for is actually this one, in which the detectability, the one in which the lifetime is very short and the detectability is very high. What about the high energy channel? So you see here, in most of the cases, the maximal distance is below the galactic scale. So this means that in order to observe the high energy component of the signal, we should have an explosion inside our galaxy, but of course this is less likely. So even if we would be in the favorite case in which the lifetime is very small, still in order to observe this component, we should be lucky to have an event happening very close to us. So the ideal situation is the one in which you see the only one of the component, whether one or the other, depending whether the explosion is happening close to us or far from us. So this is the most interesting part of what I am presenting here, because of course, how can we distinguish this the signal associated with our model with respect to all the other astrophysical signals? Well, we have a smoking gun. And this smoking gun is provided by the relation between wavelength observed and the redshift. So the more the explosion happen far from us, the farther is the explosion, the smaller should be the black hole, because the black hole should have had the time to explode, and then the signal should have had the time to travel to us. So this means if the black hole was smaller, the wavelength should be shorter for the signal associated with the low energy channel. So there is a shorter wavelength coming from this object, but at the same time, this wavelength is redshifted. And so the resulting observed wavelength is the one written there. And it's a very characteristic, it gives a very characteristic curve that is very flat. And this means that if one day we would have statistics of those signals, we may hope to fit this curve. Okay. Well, actually, this is not so. This was a smoking gun associated basically with the low energy channel. We have also a smoking gun for the high energy channel, that is the following one. So we have studied the integrated emission. So this means that we have considered the number of photons measured for a given energy in a given lapse of time for a given surface of our detectors. And so we have the integrated emission gives a characteristic shape of that is a distorted black body, not just a black body, but a distorted one. And such a distortion is not so. It's characteristic of this object. It's not it doesn't appear for any other object. So. Again, maybe the integrated emission is something that could be even easier to measure, and so this is one of the main hope for.
It's gamma rays, or what is it?
Well, it's we have calculated both for the low energy channel and for the high energy channel. So if we stay in take the case in which the lifetime is m square. This means that in the low energy channel, the integrated emission is for an emission in the radio. And for the high energy channel, it's an integrated emission in the gamma. So the high energy channel is given by the energy of the particles that formed the black hole. So it means so it depends. Actually, it's a very interesting.
Oh, it's coming from the matter, not
yeah.
It's coming from the
photons, basically. Matter. Yeah. So there is a very interesting. There is a dependence of this. Of course, this is not just so. The exact number, the exact energy depends on whether the lifetime is m cube or m square, because this means that. So this mean in this means that the black holes have to be formed before or after in the early universe. So there is a precise relation between the mass of the primordial black holes and the temperature at which it was possible to form it. So, but still, everything is around the TIV, and this kind of emission will appear as a very high gamma gamma rays. So, in order to fix the idea, low energy channel is in the radio waves, high energy channel is in the gamma. Okay. Oh, I missed this. Okay, so now the question is, have we already detected them? So have our friends in the observatories already seen any signal that is compatible with these characteristics? Well, let me start from the high energy component. For this, the thing is that so there are some gamma ray bursts that so we have measured signals on the TIV scale, but we know where are they from. On the other hand, we have not measured yet gamma ray burst on the TIV because the telescopes are not big enough. It's really a matter of dimension here. So what you need, so you know, of course, if we wanted to measure those bursts at Earth, we need to capture the shower of particles created by the burst. And the higher the burst, the larger is the surface on which this shower is distributed. So we have to wait for CTA, for the very large Cherenkov telescope array, in order to have data that could be interesting for our model. On the other hand, there is a new kid on the block. There is a new kind of signal that have puzzled astrophysicists in the last few years, and those are the fast radio bursts. And those bursts don't have yet an explanation. People are rushing to propose models, and of course, here we are. We hope that maybe our model could fit this. So the question is, do those bursts have the characteristics that match our model? Yeah, let me compare the two cases. So, yep, here we are. So what they have observed is that there are those bursts that they are in the radio waves, and the measured wavelength is of 20 centimeters. So in our case, the prediction that we have done so far is for a wavelength that is about half of a millimeter. So this means that there are a couple of order of magnitudes that we have to match. And I hope that more observation of gamma ray burst and a refinement of our model, for instance, including rotation, can make those two numbers closer. Then, of course, the fast radio bursts are very short. They last a few milliseconds. And our process, if you see it from... an explosive process, and is, by definition, very, very fast. They were not able, astrophysicists have tried to point their telescope in the direction from which they were expecting the bursts to come, and they were not able to detect any afterglow, nor any other, nor repetition, no objects there. So this is very appealing to us. So I put there the possibility in the future maybe to associate to those bursts gamma ray burst or maybe even a gravitational wave. Of course, this is a dream. I hope to see it in my life. They are punctual. There is no repetition. I already said so. The energy, the total flux of energy, is very large, is enormous. This is what is puzzling astrophysicists, and this is compatible because it's smaller than the total energy that we have predicted. So it could be likely that part of the energy goes into the burst. And well, this is an interesting point that. The estimation is that those bursts may be a very common event in our universe. And so if you believe that those objects may be primordial black holes, we also assume that they should be very common objects all around us. And this gives us hope for future detection. Okay. I think this is everything I wanted to say. I want just to leave you with this last question. So the question is open. Are fast radio bursts bouncing black holes? Well, we cross our fingers. And I would like to hear your questions and your suggestion to improve our model. Thank you very much.